Okay, so welcome to our session, Managing Incompetence and Creating Legacy. So my name is Sergio Calderini. I'm speaking from Portugal. I'm president of the Lean Academy Portugal. And yes, we have been working here in Portugal from a decade, since 2011. So a decade of learning. It's been a nice learning journey throughout the years. We have done quite several achievements here on this small rectangle, right next to Spain, for the ones that are trying to or struggling with our location. We belong here to this southwestern corner of Europe. So again, our session title, we decided to come up with something around what is being a struggling within an organization. So this managing the competency, but also the incompetency. And by meaning incompetency is not a bad word or meaning, it's just the lack of competency. And how to manage this gap and transform your organization into a learn organization or a learning organization. So we'll be discussing around these three topics. Setting a strong foundation for a lean transformation journey, stimulus and rewards for change, and creating learning organizations that leave a lasting legacy. So that's why we have invited Michael Ozio. Okay, so Mike is a friend, a colleague, a practitioner, a thinker, nothing better than just going through a small biography from his book, Toyota Culture, and states that Michael was executive director of the Center for Quality People and Organization. What is this Center for Quality People and Organization? So this is a Toyota-supported nonprofit organization dedicated to sharing the Toyota way within education, community, and business organizations throughout the experience of former Toyota leaders. And so he worked for Toyota Georgetown, Kentucky, for more than 12 years as a group leader, assembly plant manager, and manager of human resources. So Mike, welcome. We have invited Mike to share and to, well, this is not a slideshow presentation, although Mike will have a few to share. It's more of a talk. So please take advantage of having here Mike along with us for the next 60 minutes. And we'll be grateful if you use the question and answers tab on your right and on your screen. So feel free, it will be a pleasure to provide some answers and be part of our several pools. You have there on the tab, pools, we have put some questions and would be nice to have also your feedback. Okay, so again, welcome Mike.
Thank you, Sergio. Thank you for joining us. We got a small group, which means we can go deep. So. And so definitely use the chat tab and the Q&A, but also with this few people, we can open up the mic, so to speak, too, and just have discussion. I'm game for that. So looks like Andre has read the book, so I appreciate that. So you might have some questions around that. And Alice Lee, we have known a long time, a couple decades, I think, Alice. So good to have you virtually again. In the same room with me, and Gabriella, welcome from Ontario.
Okay, so that is more or less the trigger for the start of our conversation. So that is a kind of a bridge to our first part of this session. So again, we had scheduled this to have kind of three parts. And this is the first one, the managing the competency or the lack of it at the planned phase of a lean transformation journey. And again, Mike, just going through the introduction, Let me just read this paragraph so we can explore it, okay? So lots of lean journeys suffer from the syndrome of production site or production activities first, but we all know that it's so wrong. So how can you make clear to all of our viewers that all the organization needs to be on board as soon as the train leaves the station? I mean, how can we deploy a lean journey in the shop floor and then having, for instance, HR recruiting without a clue of the new set of competences needed? They all need to be aligned, right? So on the same hand, we can apply to production planning or even for finance if you want to decrease stock value in hand or increase turnover. You need to have all these persons and silos aligned. So they all need to be on board from the first second. So this is the first part of around this theme. So an open discussion around the right setup or the setting the scene. So again, Mike, what can you share with us from your Toyota learning and your journeys throughout this life as a practitioner?
Yeah, good question. I tell people I had it easy at Toyota because I was in Toyota, Kentucky in a green field. So we got to start from scratch with obviously with leadership on board. And so after I left Toyota in 1999, 2000, had 20 years now working with other companies, and very few have started with leadership, but I think it's safe to say if leadership's not engaged, the transformation will not happen. It's like Sergio said in the paragraph, it has to be the entire organization alignment. So the first thing, so now how do we get there? So the first thing is making sure our leadership knows that, leadership coaching, workshops, and I've obviously LEI does a great job of a resource to do that. I've got a Shingo model slide in here later on. Maybe I'll click on, but in my COVID, my COVID quarantine, I worked with Shingo Institute and got certified on some of their classes, but I like their model. And they made the point to Sergio's question and paragraph, we can't have operational excellence programs, right? Because it's short-lived and won't work. We have to have organizational excellence programs. And so I like that distinction as a matter of words. So starting in operations is not uncommon, it's obviously very, very common. But how in operations do we then take it to the organization? And at Toyota, that's done with, visually and problem solving. And I'm even remembering Stephen Spear, on some of his Harvard articles and such that, you start with that operational value stream, lead time, flow, et cetera. And then you start identifying, the barriers, right? The things that are hindering you. And a lot of those will start in operations as well, but quickly we'll start hitting some of the other things, and whether that's supply chain or product development or maintenance, engineering, human resources, wherever it goes, go there. So I like that because it's from a problem solving point of view, not a philosophical point of view. So setting up that value stream, setting up the metrics of that to the customer so we can link right in with business results. And because the leadership, they obviously want business results. They have to have it. That's their job. And so let's get agreement on the, again, they have the financial result. Now we have to translate that to operational, safety, quality, productivity, et cetera, lead time, those lean metrics, and then start the problem solving. And I start identifying organizationally what are those main barriers that are hindering us delivering to the customer at highest quality, lowest cost, shortest amount of time. And I found that to be a great way to pull in initially leadership, because again, we're linking to the business results, the dollars, et cetera, and then pulling in the parts of the company that are needed on that priority basis. So that's how I've seen it work on that alignment, because that's how I've seen it work from the inside out, so to speak. So that when we start from operations, pulling them in. If you're fortunate enough to have the leaders on board from the get-go, then we're just laying it out, to pull the rest of the organization in. But we'll still do the same process. We'll still have to look to do the metrics and still have to do the problem solving. So that's where I go with companies on trying to get this, again, lean transformation enterprise-wide or organizational-wide. And to Sergio's point, not just operations, because as we all know, if it stays there, it'll die there.
Yeah, but when you mean to go cross-wide the organization during the initial setup, do you really mean go through all the silos, departments, and identify within those not only the managers but the natural leaders? How can that be an easy task, or not an easy but a feasible task for the organizations and the persons that are listening to us right now?
Yeah. So again, it's kind of the two scenarios. So if the leadership is on board and we've got strong leadership, now I'm talking executive leadership, then we can do. And I'll get to this later, the true north. I think I got that on the second question. Then we can get that true north clear. We can rally around it. We can work on strategic planning or Hoshin and Connery, and to get that work in that alignment, we can do it the right way, so to speak. But again, in my experience, most times that's not the way it goes down. Most time it goes down from the inside out, from the middle out. And so that's where we go then, priority wise, what's the biggest impact, right? What's the biggest impact to the lead time, the safety, quality, productivity to the customer, et cetera. And then, cause that makes it more, one step at a time or one bite at a time or whatever you want to call it with the elephant. It helps us to focus and prioritize. And while we're doing that, then we might again pull the leadership in and pull the rest of the organization in if we can start getting those wins and start getting the stories, and then we can hopefully then shift over to where we can work that first method of getting everyone gelled around True North, Hoshin Connery, et cetera. But again, I've seen more of the latter than the former, if that makes sense.
Yeah, that's right. And not only you, but also the experience most of us have. When you mentioned those from the middle out, yeah, that's what I've been seeing most of times as well. And that is really painful, isn't it? Yeah, when you have the knowledge, you have the willing, but you need to engage not only your team, but your managers.
Right. We have to influence. But again, it's Sergio, the influence there is doing the work, doing the problem solving. So that's that, if we can do the, whatever you want to call it, the A3, the PDCA, the project, and do it very visually and visibly, then we've got our story. Then we've got our story to tell the leadership. And then if we start getting those results, then any good leader is going to say, hey, what are you doing down there? We need to look at expanding this. I got a quick kind of side story. There was a plant in Quebec. I said, we got somebody from Ontario, but Quebec. And I got them with them in a year or two into it. So they had a leader there that was wanting to work on lean. And so we went and we did some things, and he had the same thing. He's like, I have no support from my executive team, blah, blah, blah. I'm like, just keep doing what you're doing. And then he got the metrics, and I go back a year later, and he's got quality, like the defects cut in half, scrap cut in half. He's got productivity doubled. I'm like, well, have the leaders been here? And no, they haven't come. I'm like, what? I'm like, well, keep doing it, And so then the next year I find out that then he found out that he was a unionized plant, and the leadership plan was there's three non-union, one union, was to let that unionized plant die, and so that can consolidate to the non-union plant. But little did the plant manager that they hired didn't know that, and so he was working lean and working, and he was a servant leader, and he had this great success. So then we said, well, just keep going. So then the third year into it, he calls me and said, they're finally coming. to see the results. Will you do a little video for me or something? So I did a little video, and sure enough, the president came, and obviously they weren't going to close them down because they were the highest, the most successful, highest profitability, most successful plant of the four. And so now the leader was there to, how can we make the other three look like this one? So it took longer than usual, but it will happen. It will happen. That tested both of our patients on that one, because they had some extenuating circumstances. But my point is, results speak for themselves, and that's, those leaders need in the business results. So whatever your circle of influence is, your sphere of control, whatever, you know, take that as your pilot, whether that's your plant or your department or your team, and build your story, make your story with your process and results, right? Because then we can replicate and expand that process.
Yeah, exactly. So that's what kind of what we learn from all these lean thinking, right? So do your own experiments, do your own journey. What I have been struggling, and not only myself, but what I see others struggling, is that they really have a hard time just to set up the hypothesis to test, okay? There is so hard to put persons and teams making their first lean experiment. So in a nutshell, I know that there aren't silver bullets, but in a nutshell, if we want, or if you want to make a synthesis of this first part of how to set up a lean transformation or setting the scene, what would be our takeaway?
Yeah, do the experiment. Do the experiment again. We didn't use that terminology at Toyota. We were like, do the problem solving, do the plan, do check, act. But it's the same thing, right? So then that forces us to how are we going to measure our progress, and what's the gap, and what's our countermeasures, and what's the impact of our countermeasures, and that's the takeaway. I hope that because again, I never let, when I have, you know, workshops, whether a day, 2 day, 3 day, it's a common theme that they're always saying, well, you know, I need to change the leaders back home. It's like, well, the only way you're going to change it is through you, right? It's through you doing the experiment, you doing the demonstration, you doing the pilot. So I don't let them off the hook that easily. Go back and talk to your leaders and try to change their mind. The only way you're going to change your mind is, again, doing the pilot, doing the experiment, and get the results.
Yeah, that's a fact. Although can be hard, but if you don't try, at least you won't even have a result. So
sure.
Yeah. So for the ones that are there out there trying for doing their own experiments, yeah. So the recipe is just keep on doing, right?
Yeah.
So and there is no excuses, right? Because we often also listen that, I've been there, I've done it, and all that went so wrong. But as I used to say as well, it went wrong with that people at that time, on that location, on that context. So why don't give another chance, another go? So different time, different people and local can most of times, okay, trigger different results. So keep on trying, I guess.
Yes,
this
perfect.
Is the takeaway.
Yes. But okay, again, you're measuring, not just trying, right?
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. So whenever you think you should share something, just let me know. So I think that with 20 minutes on the session, we can move for the second part, okay? So the second part would be around managing, again, competency or the lack of it at the do phase of a lean transformation journey. And again, the scope is around these lines. Lots of lean journeys suffering from the syndrome of let's wait. If the guy or the team fits to the new sets of stimuli and needed behaviors, but we all know that waiting too long is again wrong. How should we handle such situations where you just know that you won't get it from some people? Most of the executives just go the hard way, which in one way sets the tone. Or you are with me or you are against me. But in the other, you are seeding fear amongst your people, and that will kill your purpose of transformation. So the second part is an open discussion around the stimuli or the stimulus and the reward for change. I have been reading something around these lines, which is the triangle of habit, the force of habit from Charles Duhigg. And he kind of put this triangle and said that every human being that does something is because it had first a stimulus and because he or she wants to achieve a reward. Even the coffee we drink in the morning. So we have the stimulus, our brain asks for caffeine, and the reward is something around, oh, it felt so good. So I think this is a great discussion to have around, right? If we want the people and the teams and whatever the organization is made of to achieve something, we need to provide their stimulus and reward. So again, Mike, what can you add?
I'm smiling because I was a psychology major. I don't know how many decades ago now that was, but and some people, and I was, one guy told me, I'd always kind of say, well, I didn't use my psychology degree, you know, in the car factory, but of course I did in leadership. And then somebody at one time said, well, you wrote the Toyota culture book, so that using your psychology degree or whatever. So I don't go too far down that rabbit trail on the stimulus response and all that. I obviously it's science and I agree with it, but I'm going to go back to my Toyota days with the question. And in a way, I guess it was stimulus response. So they were very clear on the standard. They were very clear on what should be happening. So I talked to other companies on that. That's the true north, right? So vision, values, mission, and behaviors, right? So leadership behaviors, all behaviors, core competencies, problem solving, teamwork. So these are the behaviors that we're expecting. And I love the Japanese term for that. Again, you know, the plan, do, check, act, right? You have to have a current situation in the goal or the standard or the ideal state or the future state. What they used to say is what should be happening, right? If we haven't defined what should be happening, then there's no problem, right? No standard, no problem. And you'll be surprised how many times. Now, I always challenge classes with that. It's like, you know, go back to your, or you might even have to wait till you get back, you know, your next text message or email. Ask what should be happening, and probably 50% of the time the answer you'll get is I don't know, or we don't have a standard. And so no standard, no problem. So on these behaviors, the biggest gap I've seen again in an organization is they haven't clearly defined what should be happening. And if you can't define that, then you have no problem. And so I also give in my longer workshops many, many examples of where they told me my behaviors and my thinking, hence, or words or behaviors were no good, Mike, son, right? And by the end of the 2 or 3 days, they're laughing about how many times I have the no good, Mike, son story. But I told him I took that personally at first, but then I learned there's nothing personal about it. It's like, here's the standard. And if your thinking or behavior is not matching the standard, it's no good. And so those were the expected behaviors. So those are then how we hired people at Toyota. They had to demonstrate those competencies and behaviors of problem solving and teamwork in order to get hired. In order to get promoted, you obviously have to demonstrate that you did the problem solving, teamwork. Now you have to demonstrate you're able to coach, because the expected behavior is leader as coach. And so if I'm out there on the floor as a supervisor manager, and I remember the one time, you know, the guy had a problem. So I run up and I'm in the middle of the firefighting and I give him the answer. Solve the problem. My trainer says, no good, Mike, son. I'm like, what do you mean no good? I just solved the problem. That was the problem, Mike, son. That's not your role as supervisor. Your role as supervisor is to coach them to solve the problem. Teach the fish, don't give a fish. So as simple as that is as difficult and challenging as that is, right? So but that's the simplicity of the stimulus response. So I had a negative response when I gave an answer. And if I coach, then I get a positive reinforcement, like, good job, Mike, son. Or when I learn how to do that, then I get a promotion because now I'm coaching and not directing or giving answers. So again, don't confuse easy with simple. So I always try to, and that's as simply as the Japanese did it. It's like, here's what should be happening. If it's not, it's no good. Identify it and correct it, right? Address it. You know, sometimes even, go ahead. Yeah.
No. And I just imagined that while they were saying to you, no good, Mike, and they were with you at the Gamba.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So again, if you want to have and to be aware of what would be these stimulus rewards, follow the standards, coach your people, you need to be there for them. Right.
Yeah, with the standard though, because if there's no clear standard, then it's not a no good, right?
Yeah. So lead us a little bit through about those standards. Are you talking about operational standards, management standards, or just assembly standards?
Yeah. Well, we had what we called, core competencies and then position competencies. So the core competency, like problem solving and teamwork, everybody is expected to do. And then the leadership behavior of coaching, obviously leaders are supposed to do, just as a quick example. There's a lot of more detail behind it, but that's a starting point. But again, another story, I remember in Australia one time I was given a talk and somebody came up at the first break and said, we love what you're talking about, but we got a guy back home who wouldn't even come to this because he doesn't agree with Lean, wouldn't even come to this conference. It was an LEI conference, actually. Wouldn't even come to this conference. And what should we do with him? I'm like, is that a problem? And they're like, well, yes, it's a problem. We can't go any further. He's holding up our team. He's 1/5 of our leadership team. I said, I didn't ask you if it was an issue. I know it's making issues. I was asking, remember our problem PDCA discussion? No standard, no problem. I was asking you, is there a set of leadership behaviors back home for you that you're living by? And they're like, oh, no, we don't have that. All we have is our opinion and his opinion. And that's all we argue about is our opinions. We don't have a standard that says okay or no good. All right. So then that was their task, obviously, going back home is creating that standard. So simple, not easy. Simple, not easy.
Yeah, which in a way seems hard for us, right? Simple, not easy. Yeah, so simple is hard to achieve, right?
Yeah.
When we talk through our kind of sharing sessions, providing consultancy or whatever, it's a common place to talk about those standards. And nowadays, it's more and more obvious that everybody needs to have a standard, from the CEO to the manager to the supervisor back to the leader, and
everybody.
Obviously the operator or the persons that are on the shop floor, whatever that means.
That's right.
But from my perspective, from what I've been seeing, not only in Portugal, Europe, and some other places in the world, and we are just scratching the surface in terms of non-operational standards, meaning assembly or manufacturing standards, right?
Right.
Is that your feeling as well, or
only
a feeling, is a fact for you?
It's a fact, no doubt. But again, LEI, I think, helps kind of plow the ground or pioneer this. I remember, John Shook a couple of years ago with the transformation model, coming out and having there in the middle leadership behaviors, right? So so that's heading in the right direction, because like you said, it's all too common for just the operational standards, even when you say operational standards, just of the product or the piece or part, not even of standard work. They've got it, they've gotten written from the engineers, but not developed by the team member. That's a whole nother story and topic, but
absolutely,
we won't necessarily have to go there right now, but
The standard is your following.
So they don't have any involvement or engagement, but then to take it beyond that to these behaviors, teamwork behaviors, problem solving behaviors, coaching behaviors. Yeah, that's the next level. But that's, of course, that's culture stuff we're talking about, and that's transformation stuff we're talking about. So that's where we got to go.
Back to those other days, or even if you have that knowledge right now of how Toyota is handling nowadays these kind of non-operational standards or management standards, can you just take us through one example?
Yeah, I'm trying to read the comments here to see if we got questions going. So I was reading while you were asking, so I missed your question.
Yeah, multitasking. That's
I was reading Tanya's question. Go ahead, and then I'll try to weave them together too.
Yeah, we can mix it together. I was just asking if you have one example of one of those management standards that you can give us as something to try to understand the purpose, and then for the ones that are listening to us, kind of trying to create their own experiments out of the example. I don't know if you have that on the top of mind. If you don't, we can just...
Two of them are... the two biggest gaps I see, one with kind of the operators and the other with the leaders. I've already mentioned them, so everyone's expected to problem solve and work in a team, right? And that teamwork also kind of goes back to the first one of the silos and, cutting through the silos and make it all heading in the true north direction. But the problem solving is where I was going. So the standard work, the operator standard work, the operator engagement, the operator problem solving, the operator improvement is the biggest gap that drives my passion to stay in this field of trying to impact that. Because it's most of the time not happening. And that's where the magic is. That's where the numbers are. Just look at any organization and that's where your numbers are on that front line. And so when we can educate them and we can give them the tools, the time, the understanding, the information, the competency to do that, it's a great thing for everybody. And so that's one where I would like to see some more experiments. And even relating back to our standard work discussion, if I had thought of it, I would have had the poll question. I did through these Skype days of COVID. What's the purpose of standard work, operator standard work? What's the purpose? I say, improving quality, training, improving, helping training, something else. I say, safety, whatever, all the above or none of the above. And 90% of people will say all the above and a couple will say, safety or quality or whatever. And the answer in my learning is none of the above. I say, what is the primary purpose of operator standard work? And those are benefits and advantages. The primary purpose of operator standard work is to make improvement, for the operator to make improvement so that they, again, know what's currently happening and then what could be happening and solving that gap. The purpose of operator standard work is to make improvement. And we don't, that's missed most everywhere and anywhere. Again, I've got poll question data to support that. So that would be one experiment I would like for folks to work on, is that operator standard work and that operator problem solving. That's the behavior we want them doing. Of course, we want them doing their job with safety and quality and productivity. That's the bare minimum. Then we want them improving that. So that's one experiment I would go. Then the other one would be the leaders coach thing that we're talking about.
Right.
So, because leaders are out there doing everything but firefighting, traffic cop,
absolutely,
policeman, et cetera, director, authoritative. So working on them and their ability to problem solve and then coach and teach problem solving is another experiment I like to do.
I was told by some persons working also in Toyota, that they have this kind of quote that the operator is king.
That's right.
Was that something that you use as well?
We used to say expert, operator's the expert. But yeah, I mean, it's the whole servant leader triangle, right? That the operators are at the top, they're the value add, they're what the customer's paying for, they're paying our bill, we're all non-value added. I mean, I had my first promotion, I told somebody I had 200 people working for me now. And my trainer grabbed me and said, you know, took me aside, said, no good, Mike son. You know, that's
no good, Mike son.
That's not
that so good.
That at Toyota, you are working for those 200 people now. Let me teach you how you work for them, how you support them, like we said earlier, how you give them the equipment, the information, the time, the training, the development, et cetera, that they need in order to perform their role and improve.
Yeah. So you are a provider, right? Yeah,
that's correct.
Yeah. Yeah. That's very nice. So let's just end up the second part here with Tania Lyon. Comment and question.
Yeah, because I think Tanya's question is not uncommon today, right? If I give it to you right, Tanya said, hey, we got so much turnover right now and there's labor shortage that we can't, you know, we're just trying to get the basic services, not improvement. And even during the COVID, there's kind of two thoughts I have on this. So even during the COVID, I heard a lot of comments on like, how in the heck can we do lean and CI when we're going through this catastrophe? And then the other side was, man, lean and CI has gotten us through this catastrophe. Not even only got us through it, but they've like grown us through it. And like we've adjusted this and adjusted that, adjusted our market, adjusted our packaging. I was at the one food company. They went from big, huge servings to for catering to these little small packages that they could send out. And their nimble, agile, lean production system allowed them to like switch on a dime and capture the market share that the people weren't doing. So we got to be clear on, hey, you know, CI is the way we do business, not when we have time to do it, right? And because we'll never have time to do it. There always will be another whatever, right? Recession or depression or whatever. So we got to be kind of clear on that, on our true north. Like that CI is what we do every day. It's not a program. It's not a project. It's not a team. It's us. It's what we do. Now on your staffing thing, that's a very real problem right now. But again, I kind of give the same answer from the lean perspective. And I just had a quote from somebody here not too long ago. That said, we don't have a hiring problem. There's no problem getting them here. There's a problem keeping them. You know, and maybe it was an HR person. I don't know. They're like, we're getting them in. And actually it was a hospital I was talking, I won't tell you where, that we're getting them in the door. They're just leaving at a quicker rate than they're coming in. And so we got to work on obviously what's happening when the time they come into the door, the time they go out the door to prevent that. And now, you know, and that usually would take me to there's two things usually there. I had another company that said, and their turnover is like 55%. And then when they dug down into it, 90% of it was within the first 3 to 6 months. And so that guy's quote was, we don't have a turnover problem. We have an onboarding problem. Now it could be a hiring problem, you know, for far as matching to the competencies, but we can do our problem solving, right? So are we hiring for the right, you know, for the right skill and competency behavior to win? What's our standard there? And then how are we onboarding? Because most of it's happening in that onboarding where they don't feel like they're thrown to the fire or they're doing whatever, non-value added, stressed. And if you do your exit interviews, you'll find out that. And then included in that, then their secondary thing is the treatment by the supervisor. You know, and are the supervisors nurturing and coaching and working to the success, or are they running around and, you know, and throwing the people on the job? Now, I had a Gemba workshop, that's maybe been a month and a half ago. And we were doing these types of discussions, and then it was really cool because they were like, they opened the Gemba and now let's go and see. So they talked about, oh, we've got an onboarding thing and we've got this and that, and this was happening, da, da, da. And when we went and talked to the supervisor, oh yeah, we're doing our onboarding. We do this, 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 and this. well, let's go talk to, I caught him somewhere in there, and I'm like, well, have you talked to a new hire? Well, no, let's go talk to a new hire. So, you know, the answer, the new hire's like, well, no, I got thrown on the job, you know, and they told me they didn't have time to meet, you know, and I'm stressed as heck. And, you know, and so, and so they were able to identify that gap because of the Gemba workshop we were doing. So you got to do your Gemba workshop, you know, and find out, you know, do you have a standard for the onboarding, and then is it happening? And then what's the role of the supervisor during that onboarding? Again, kind of, again, are they the teacher, coach, mentor, nurturing this, or are they the traffic cop, you know, that's or the firefighter? So that's my answer to you on that. So work on your onboarding, your hiring onboarding first. First do your problem solving, but I'm assuming that's where most of yours is. But in my experience, that's where most of yours is. But you need to check.
Yeah, and usually, Mike, it goes even worse before it gets better, right? Because when you are, as Tanya is suggesting, on scenarios of extreme scarcity, you still need to deliver the health services and support. So you, on right. that, you need to do problem solving. So it will become worse before it comes better.
Well, I like your point.
Extreme effort.
Yeah, because it's a vicious cycle, right? Because it is. Just like this lady was saying, it's like, well, you know, they told me they didn't have time to do the thing, you know, and they don't have time because somebody else just left. Now if they don't take the time on this one, now they'll leave. You know?
So, absolutely.
So we got to stop it. And that's what I told him. Like, you got the standard. Now you got to like do anything you can to follow that standard and see if that works. But if you not only do the standard, then you don't have an experiment.
Yeah, and the less resources you have, the more need of a standard.
Right. So we got to get that cycle. Well. We got to get that cycle turned. And I think I even mentioned, I don't know if it was either of those two conversations, was like, hey, maybe you need to request some extra people initially, you know, to help you follow that, you know. And if you got such a high attrition rate anyway, so go ahead and, you know, do a little pre-hire or, you know, pull forward a couple so that you can follow your standard and stop the drain, you know.
Right.
People. So,
but when you are not able or no people available, or for budget reasons you just can't, well, it will rely on their shoulders to come up with some answers, and that's very painful.
It is. So it is. Especially when you're
for you and all the others that are supporting our health services throughout the nation. Thanks.
Right.
So, very good. Mike, maybe we can just bridge to our third and last part of our session, okay? So, and it's about creating legacy along this transformation journey. So again, the scope would be something around these lines. Lots of lean journeys suffer from the syndrome of, it was nice and easy while I was leading, but I just can't guarantee that it holds with me leaving the position or the company. But we all know that relying on a person to hold a lean transformation is a recipe for catastrophe. So how should most of the companies create this awareness, and how should they prepare for it, where any new incoming executive just don't have the freedom or the need to put everything done aside and start all over again from a blank sheet of paper? So an open discussion around learning organizations, legacy, and change management.
Yeah.
And I bet you have good stories on legacy on learning organizations.
Well, I like your questions. They get me going. They get my passion. So I would, like when you said creating a legacy, yeah, you know, Toyota was all about creating systems. And when I think that's why I like the Shingo stuff that I was going over last winter, because, you know, they talked about, again, you know, the tools doesn't cut it, right? The tools are just a little piece of the puzzle. And so we have to have these business results, like we were saying. And then the, you know, the executives and the leaders, you know, they need to work on this true north, like we were saying, with identifying what should be happening, these behaviors, these competencies. And then Shingo has what they, then they have a triangle on the systems and say, then it's the, and they kind of usually say the middle manager's working on the systems, it, formal systems on how to then create the, get these behaviors that we're talking about. And so I love that, because that, that's what we did at Toyota. That's what I put in the Toyota culture book. It's like, you know, and I still get questions from people. At, I was at a healthcare conference. Maybe it was pre-COVID, but it was 500 people. And the question was, you know, was culture intentional at Toyota? Or was it, it just kind of happened? It was like, it was very, very, I wasn't sure she was serious first, but then I found out she, and I saw she was. It was very, very intentional. It was not an accident. You know, again, starting with this true north and the Toyota way, and then being very clear on the competencies and behaviors like we talked about, and then building the systems to get those behaviors. And so whether that's the hiring system, or like we said, the onboarding system, or the daily management system, or the suggestion system, or the problem solving systems, those are the systems we're building in order to get the behaviors, the ideal behaviors that we said. And if we're, if the actual behaviors, and it, and Shingo also defined your culture with you as your actual behaviors. And I kind of like that simplicity. It's like your culture is your current behaviors of your people. And again, do you, is it a problem? If there's no standard, there's no problem. And then of course we'll have a gap, and then we adjust the systems. So, so Toyota was like, you know, that was even part of their promotion. You know, I couldn't, I, they wouldn't promote me to system manager until they pulled me out of the group, you know, to work on some projects, to work on, you know, as an acting manager. And then they would assign a, you know, an acting to see if the group runs without you. Right. That's, then we see is how, then we see, was, did they build, did I have build systems in my group, in my team, to carry on without me? We didn't use the term legacy, but that was, but that was it, right? See how well they run without the leader there. Did they build the system? Then if, and then if it, it's built, then it's like, okay, he did his job there. Now he's ready for the next level.
And how did they perform that test? It's kind of putting you aside for one week or?
It was more like, it was longer, probably 4, 6, 2 months, maybe, you know, because again, it's like, then I can be an acting. Now I'm going and acting and pulling for somebody else who's doing the same thing. And then, so it was a good way to kind of, for the promotion process, like, you know, to kind of prove out the person on the rising side, as well as the person being out, did they build the systems in there? And so the point was, you know, and again, with Toyota, I left Toyota after 13 years and we all talked to each other. It's like the system keeps cranking, right? Because and that's what we'd worked on, is building the system to go without us.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah. That, can you, from your experience, can you just confirm or not? But it's my assumption that Toyota don't hire from the market. Every manager is kind of trained and grow inside the company up to the point that, that he or she becomes a manager or a director or senior or whatever.
Yeah.
Is it right? Is it done this way?
It's the standard. Now, obviously, you have to hire from the market. So they're not, they don't promote from the market, right? So it's a promote from within standard. Now, that doesn't mean we didn't always hit that. But that was the standard, meaning that I remember, I forget if it was the end of the 80s, early 90s, where our growth, you know, I started at Toyota Kentucky with 1,500 people on one shift. And then, I don't know, it was 10, 15 years later, it was 45,000 people Toyota North America. So somewhere in there, you know, our growth outpaced our development, our ability to develop the leaders. And we did go outside. And but it was a problem. So then the problem is, you know, how do you keep this from happening again? So how do we speed up our growth to keep them, to keep up with our development? I'm sorry, how do we speed up our development to keep up with our growth? So that was the point. And you started getting into it, the reasons why, the benefits of that, because they're they're understanding the culture, they're understanding the systems. And then once you learn that, then you're ready for the next one. And so many benefits to promoting from within. And they used to say, people would say, well, how do you get fresh eyes or new blood or whatever? It's like, you get those through the, you know, the entry level. And then also we had horizontal rotation. You know, I was rotated to human resources after 10 years in operations, knowing nothing about human resources, but so that I could go learn PDCA. You know, I can't go up to HR and do directive command and control. I gotta rely on my people. I have to coach and facilitate plan, do, check, act. So you are correct. They promote from within is definitely a standard and a true north, and very beneficial again for the individual and for the company. But man, is it a long-term investment, right? It's a longer-term investment. Even when I talk to companies about rotating, how would you rotate leaders that know nothing about? It's like, well, you obviously don't do everybody at once, but obviously it was a hit. Because I remember rotating my people. It's like, I just got them trained, now I got to rotate them. You know, but that's for the benefit of them and the organization, right? It's that long-term benefit, that long-term thinking.
Yeah, that's so much to talk about it. And yeah, that was an assumption that I have now confirmed. That's what everything I read points to, have that as a standard. But yeah, it's really good to know as a fact that somehow they capitalize on that management system.
Yes.
I don't know why being this something that is a lesson learned, a management best practice, why we are keep on seeing these even multinationals keeping that same mistake, keeping on performing that same mistake, hiring from the exterior, bringing in, and then just it's a kind of a person lands on a team, department, area, organization, and their first survival instinct is to rely on their back competencies and not on the actual situation.
Right.
Whoa, and yeah. That really harms the culture.
It's back to that leadership. You know, that just reminded me of a company that I was working with, but and they had just redone their group leader role, supervisor, and they said, well, there was only one team leader ready for promotion. All the rest, they went and hired outside. And when I asked, did you promote from within? Like, no, none of them are ready. I'm like, well, why? That's a problem. So are you working on that? Cause I can't argue too much. It's like, okay, well then to run the business, then you might have to go hire. It's kind of like we just said, you know, by making it a true north that when you violate it, it's a problem. And just like the Toyota example, same thing I went through with them. It's like, okay, well now if it's not a problem, you have to make it a standard. And they agreed. They're like, okay, we don't want to do that again. We want to promote from it. Okay, well then that's our new standard. Now, how are we going to keep it from happening again? How are we going to have those team leaders ready for the next opening? So then that's a productive conversation. So that's the way I would kind of coach folks to work towards that. Like short term, you may have to do it. But hopefully it's a problem that you're working to keep it in from happening again.
Okay. Yeah, so just for us to stick to our basic principles, voice of the customer, we have here a last, I think, question from Robert. He kind of puts the question around, well, maybe it's a long
virtual Kiemba. Yeah.
Yeah, how to develop leaders around these distributed geography now with the pandemic issue.
Yeah, it's a great question, Robert. I think it is possible, and I've seen, you know, again, it's kind of that necessity is the mother of invention or whatever. So that COVID really kind of like, even the fact that we're having this thing right now, right, is an offshoot of the COVID, you know, Zoom or Skype of days phenomenon. So I've seen lots of companies taking that technology and then applying it to the daily huddles. Because prior to COVID, they were like, how do you do this? Well, you know, we got sales teams all over the country, or we got this or that, or, you know, different locations. And And we would say, well, everybody's doing it virtually. So the COVID has kind of sped that up. So now there are companies that are doing it and doing it quite well. And developing the hybrid. Because I was at one company and they were doing the remote huddle. But I was on my computer and the guy right on the desk across from me was on his computer. It's like, no, I don't think that's the right hybrid. The hybrid is kind of like you're saying, is like it's this go and see. Like we can have a we got the technology to have a camera even at the huddle board. And then even when we walk to the Gemba from the huddle board, and we're pulling in those virtual folks in that live. And so I've done some workshops virtually with that. So I've done some virtual Gemba walks, hybrid, having, you know, a group of people live and a group of people virtually. So the answer is yes. So go for it. And do your plan, do, check, act, right? So that's your system that you're going to modify. Some things will work, some things will won't, and then modify it, adjust it again. But companies are doing it. So yes, definitely I would encourage you to go there.
Yeah, I think that we can escape from this virtual world now. So we'll need to come up with a kind of solution. Even if it is a different solution for different organizations on how to develop leaders.
Exactly, right.
Yeah, on this virtual new world, so this metaverse, as I'm learning as well.
Yeah, I'm using the hybrid word there, because again, everybody, no, I haven't found anybody that disagrees that face to face is better. But we have learned to do lots of things adequately virtually, so there's a way to leverage that. And do the hybrid. So
So we just need to learn the tweaks and turns, how to set up those knobs, and right. In order to take out the most of the online.
Right.
Okay, so we are almost at the end. So it was an hour, it just flew out, right? And time flies by. Thank you so much, Mike, for your input and contribution. To also be part of the Lean Global Tech Connection. So huge event, take advantage of it, listen, learn, experiment, do your own tries. Your last words, Mike, to you, so you can close the session.
Yeah. Usually my last words on a workshop are go and do PDCA. So go and do your experiment would be my last words. You'll do the learning.
Absolutely. Fantastic.
Thank you, Sergio. Thank you all for joining.
Thank you for joining as well. Okay. Take care. Right. See
Bye-bye.
You soon. Bye-bye.